So I'm a professor at Touro University, and I teach a little bit at Berkeley also, where I did all my education. And my background is biophysics, and my research, my lab research, is in molecular and cellular mechanisms of development of form in the nervous system. So how the neural tube forms, or how nerves grow in your brain and form the right patterns of connections. So, what I'm going to talk to you about today are three art science projects that I did with students at Touro that started actually just out of frustration with my research not going anywhere. And I sort of took a step back and kind of like reapproached what I was doing from what originally drew me to this research, which was the beauty of patterns in cells in developing embryos. And so let me start with that. And the first two projects I'm going to talk about have been published, and the last one is sort of still under development. So the first one is A Celebration of Form in Biology and Art, or How I Got the Art World to Fund My Biology Lab Research. This started because I kept getting grant rejections from the NIH, and they were all saying like the work's too descriptive, because a lot of what we do in the lab research is sort of perturb genes and then see how patterns of cells are changed in the brain, and a lot of math analysis of those patterns. So I thought, so when I got this grant rejection, I also was looking at an art book. And this book was a monograph of the abstract expressionist painter Sam Francis. And I'm going to show you that one of his paintings that inspired it. But generally, Sam Francis is a post-World War II abstract expressionist painter, and he has biomorphic forms in his paintings. And one of them really, really reminded me of my PhD thesis. So first, just a little bit about him. So he was a pre-med at UC Berkeley before World War II. Took zoology and histology, so he saw a lot of cells and embryos and tissues. And then he went into the Air Force during World War II, and he had a flying accident, and while he was recuperating, he decided to become, he started painting, and decided to return to Berkeley as an art history major. And after he graduated from Berkeley, he went to Paris almost immediately, and became famous right away for these huge abstract paintings full of biomorphic shapes. And he's from California. He was the first internationally collected California artist. So this is a painting that I was looking at. This is in the book Sam Francis by Peter Sells. And I was looking at this painting abstract in 1923, and I thought, oh my goodness, this is my PhD thesis. So this looks exactly like the cells make PhD thesis. And what my PhD thesis was a study of neural tube formation in frog embryos. And I would cut out pieces of frog embryo neural ectoderm. And it would kind of like do the movements of narrowing and elongation that happens when you form a neural tube. And this is a still from a time lapse. I'm going to show you the time lapse of the second project. This is still from the time lapse, and this was published in my PhD work. And so there's lots of cells in here. And the cells, I spent hours mathematically analyzing the patterns of movements and the shape of these cells. So when I saw this painting, I said, oh my goodness, that's convergent extension. That's neural ectoderm. These cells look exactly like my PhD. So I came up with this project that I was going to quantitatively show what was similar between Sam Francis's painted forms and biological tissues. And I decided to pair three of Sam Francis's paintings with three biological lookalike tissues. One was going to be from my PhD thesis, and the other two were going to be from histology slides that I teach the medical students. And we're going to use morphometric measurements that we use in our developmental biology research, that these are shape measurements, and use a software that we use to measure cells in microscopic images and compare them and mathematically specify why his paintings look like nature and like biology. And since I was thinking like, oh, will somebody fund this project, I decided I had to have an art history collaborator. And I noticed that the author of this monograph, Peter Sells, was a retired emeritus art history professor at Berkeley. So I emailed him with the title, Mathematical Analysis of Sam Francis Paintings, and I said, I have this project idea, can I come and talk to you? I'd love to have you as a collaborator. And he wrote back right away, and he said, yes, come to my house, I have original Sam Francis paintings, I'm really happy to meet you. So like, I came to his house in the North Berkeley Hills, And I didn't realize at the time that not only was he an artist at the University of Berkeley, he is like a major figure in the modern art world. So he was a curator at MoMA in New York. He was hired by Berkeley to start the Berkeley Art Museum. And he not only was friends with Sam Francis, but he was friends with all of these major modern artists. We had original Dubuffet. He has like original paintings all over his house. And I'm in his house showing him my kidney histology lecture that I showed to the medical student. And he's saying, oh yes, this is beautiful. I can see why the resemblance, but why, yes, I'll support the project. So he agreed to participate as an art history advisor in this project. And then around the same time, I realized there was a Sam Francis Foundation dedicated to preserving the legacy of Sam Francis. So I wrote to them with this project idea, and I said, I'm looking for a little bit of funding to support student researchers. And they said, oh, this sounds really interesting. We have a board meeting in 3 days. Write up a proposal, and we'll discuss it then. And so they discussed it, they liked it, and they sent me a check within 2 weeks to fund the project. So that was really nice. It wasn't a lot, but it was, I mean, it's good. So the project was pairing paintings and biological images. And so the first pairing was the abstraction and the neural ectoderm. The second one is a painting called Deep Orange and Black and White Blood Smear. And specifically, we were comparing these cell forms to white blood cell nuclei. And then the third pairing was kind of obvious because later on, Sam Francis did a series of paintings called Blue Balls. And this was when he was suffering from kidney tuberculosis, and people said, oh, this looks like kidney. So we paired one of the paintings from the Blue Ball series called Also Violet to renal histology, a kidney histology slide. And so we outlined 12 or so forms in each of these images. And then we used two mathematical shape measurements that are dimensionless because we're comparing, you know, microscopic cells to huge forms in large paintings. And so we need dimensionless measurements. And so the first one is aspect ratio, which is length to width. So it's sort of how ectomorphic a shape is. And then the second one is circularity, which is a dimensionless ratio between area and perimeter squared. And circularity ranges from 0 to 1. A perfect circle has a circularity of 1, and any shape that is more irregular or elongated than a circle will have a lower circularity. So we performed these measurements on the forms that we had outlined, and then these are the results. So using the student's t-test in terms of aspect ratio and circularity, there was no significant difference between the painted forms and the biological tissues. So in blue, we have the painted forms, and in red next to it is the paired biological tissue. So this kind of showed that we had specified that forms in Sam Francis paintings are similar in aspect ratio and circularity to biological forms. And the aspect ratio was always like 1.6 to 1.8, and the circularity was around 0.75. And so this similarity to biology maybe explains a little bit of the psychological appeal of his paintings, because we're used to looking at forms with these shapes and these natural sizes, and so we may then respond well to them. So we may prefer to look at forms that are not perfect circles. We don't see a lot of perfect circles in nature. We see sort of off-circle forms. And so we wrote this up, and this was published in the Leonardo Journal, and actually the copy of the Leonardo Journal on the table has the article in it. Okay. So, and one reviewer pointed out that we had defined a morphometric signature also for all of his paintings, because all the paintings were the same as well. They all sort of, whether it was a small form in a painting or a large form in a painting, they all had this aspect ratio of 1.6 to 1.8 and a circularity of 0.75. So he kind of was doing the same thing over and over in very different ways. And also this aspect ratio, which is the golden ratio, 1.6 to 1.8, is also found. So one reviewer who I think was a friend of mine who's a bioengineer, was kind of a very humorous person, and when I got back the review, he was like trying to send me to Paris to look at more articles and things like that. But he also pointed out that the aspect ratio of 1.6 to 1.8 is found in nature beyond biology, so he sent back a picture of mud cracking. And when you look at mud cracking, it also forms these shapes that look like cells that have an aspect ratio of around 1.7. So that was the first project. And then, okay, so project two. In this project, we sort of kind of did in a way the opposite thing. We used this visual artist programming language. So I was working on another project with an artist that didn't go anywhere, but she had suggested this programming language to me called Processing. Processing was developed at MIT Media Lab by Casey Reese and Ben Fry, and it's developed for visual artists to learn programming or visual programming in other fields. It's Java-based, free, and open source, and I thought it would be a really good thing to get students interested in programming and modeling and morphogenesis and cells and things like that. So I proposed to two students that they make aesthetic animations of cell dynamics based on movies I had made in my PhD, and which is on neural tube formation, and I'll show you those, and of optic axon branching, which is what I've studied for the last 15 years. So I'm first going to show you sort of the real biology, and then I'll show you the animation. So here is, again, this is from a Fiji. So this is like an explanted tissue from a frog embryo, and this was cut out with a knife that was created with an eyebrow hair. So the eyebrow hair is your knife. You put it in a glass pipette, and then you cut out a little square of tissue, and it undergoes, it sort of makes like a little spinal cord. And what it does is it's called convergent extension. It narrows and lengthens. And we all do that. All vertebrate embryos do that process. That's why your head is no longer near your butt. So that's convergent extension. And this, so what I would do is I would make these explants, and then we would make higher magnification movies. So this shows you to look at what the cells were doing to narrow and lengthen the tissue. So this is a higher magnification movie, and I traced hundreds of cells in these and figured out the patterns of movements and the individual cell shape changes and things that were going on during that. So what is driving the narrowing and lengthening of the tissue is rearrangement of the cells. And so that's shown here. So this is four cells, but they're in a field of hundreds of cells like you just saw. But I only labeled four of the cells here. And the cells are rearranging. So you can see the yellow cell comes in between the green and the red cell and pushes them apart, and it generates a narrower and longer array. And that's happening. That's how then the whole tissue narrows and lengthens. And so that's called unilateral intercalation. And while these cells are rearranging, they're also like sort of doing, you know, amoeboid movements. You can tell there's a lot of jiggling, both of cell positions and of cell boundaries as well. And so the animation the student made was just of one cell trying to recapitulate a sort of amoeboid-like movement. And this shows you the results, but I'll show you the animation in a minute. So this is a biological cell showing that it both moves and changes shape. And then our model cell did the same thing. So in the next, so these are the parameters, just grossly, not in detail, that went to the program. So we had to parameterize cell shape. So we just set like 8 nodes around the cell. The cursor was the force attracting the cell. And then the bulk of the program was focused on the relationship between cell shape and cell movement. So as the cell moves, it has to deform, but not too much. And so that was, so there was a lot of like, the nodes move semi-autonomously. There was a little bit of randomness that was put into it. And then the next shows you side by side. So on the right is a movie that I made of cells rearranging, and on the left is our model cell. And the idea is like, can you imagine this model cell being one of those? Does it move, have the same character of movement? So and the one on the right is looping.
Guiding the movement?
The cursor. It's the cursor's attracting it, that's why I
What's
the tracker? The animated cell. The real cells, we'll talk about that.
So the nodes are autonomous?
The nodes are semi-autonomous. There is, I'll have to go back and look at the program, but there's a little bit of stochasticity, like randomness to the new position of each node, but yet there's some constant that keeps them all together. So the next model we did was of optic axon branching. And so this is when axons, so these are like nerve projections, when they reach their target in the developing brain, they often extend branches, and that serves to increase the number of synapses they can make with target neurons. And it's also, these branches are very dynamic, and that structural plasticity underlies learning and memory in the adult brain. And so this shows you a living optic axon imaged in a tadpole brain, and it's imaged every 2 hours. And I didn't take these pictures, but I take pictures similar to this. And you can see the arrow that branches are extending at number 2 and retracting at number 3. And so we wanted to kind of capture the dynamics of this. And this shows sort of the results of the model that it changes, you know, every iteration. The structure of the arbor grows and changes. And so the parameters that went into optic axon branching modeling were very simple. Just we started with a straight line and then specified that it would bifurcate into a certain number of branches. And in this model, the student made it so you could actually modify, the user could choose how many branches you wanted it to bifurcate into. The angle of branches, and here you specify the angle of branches, but you actually specify a maximal angle of branches, and then there's a sort of random number that's generated between 0 and that maximum angle, because he thought when he looked at this that the branching angles were changing over time. And then the thickness of branches decreases as they bifurcate. And so this is the animation the student made, and this was with a bifurcation of 2 branches and a branching angle of 65, which was the average branching angle that we measured. So this is supposed to kind of be, it's like a mimic or exaggeration of what's going on in your brain. But someone I showed this to thought it looked, it reminded them of seaweed. Like when they're diving. So, and then okay. So next thing is the real one. But we'll skip that. So the last project I'll just touch on is quantitative analysis of branching patterns in nature. So this is a project that 2 medical students at Touro decided to do. One worked as an artist before coming to medical school, the other one was an environmental scientist. And so they decided that they were gonna, that there's a lot of branched forms in nature in very diverse contexts with very diverse functions, but they all sort of look similar. So they decided to take a Purkinje neuron image, which is the most highly branched neuron in the brain, an image of a river delta, and an image of a slime mold, and mathematically compare the branching in them to see if there's similarity among diverse branch forms, similarity on the fine scale level among diverse branch forms in nature. And for this, the morphometric measurements that they used are the ratio of parent to daughter branch width. So as they branch, the branch width gets smaller, but what is that ratio? And then they also measured the fractal dimension using the box counting dimension. And here what you do is you put a grid over the branch structures of smaller, smaller box sizes, and you count the number of boxes that have branched material in them and plot that versus the grid size or the log of it. And the slope of those lines gives you the fractal dimension. And fractal dimension is very hard to define what it is, but it's sort of like a measurement of the density of the object. And for self-similar objects like this, when you zoom in, they look the same as when you zoom out. And so the scale should not change the density of it. So the results of their measurements are here. So the ratio of daughter to parent branch width was all 0.9 for the 3 branched forms. And the fractal dimension for all of these came out to be around 1.7 to 1.8. And so the conclusion of this is that, at least based on this images, the Purkinje neuron, river delta, slime mold are statistically similar, branch with width of fractal dimension. And so we've mathematically specified fine-grained similarity between diverse branched forms in diverse contexts and sizes in nature. And our results kind of also speak to the limited number of forms found in nature, which is sort of the artistic perspective on all of this. So that is it, and these are the students that worked on this project. So the first one was a tourist student who now is a family practice resident, a Berkeley student who works at Google. The second one was a tourist student who's a radiology resident now, and a student who's trying to get to medical school, and then the last two are current tourist students. And this shows one of the tourist students in an elective I teach, or a sort of elective activity, where they're creating their own art based on histology.